Good morning, City of Refuge and extended family. I'm Key Ellis. Welcome to the City of Refuge United Church of Christ. We are a ministry of restoration. We are intentionally, radically inclusive, welcoming all persons, regardless of race, color, ancestry, age, gender, ability, sexual, or affectional orientation. We celebrate the Creator's diversity. We worship Christ and welcome persons from all faith paths, which harmonize with the ministry of Jesus Christ. Reverend Dr. Yvette Flunder, presiding bishop of the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries and senior pastor of Refuge Ministries, the pastoral team, and the entire congregation, thank you for worshiping with us today. If you're a first-time visitor or have been away for a while and you're returning, please let us know by typing #visitor in the chat. And refugees, let's show our visitors and those returning some love.
God bless you, Key. Thank you for that beautiful welcome. And welcome indeed to all of City of Refuge. We are so glad to be with you and to be together again. We're so grateful for the gift of another day of life, health, and strength, which wasn't promised to us. I tell you, saints, this has been a week that has challenged the notion of whether or not we have good religion. We've had moments of hope. We've had followed by moments of despair as we continue to live in a nation that is struggling to know what indeed is good religion. That's our theme this year. Have we got good religion? And so as we move toward a time of prayer after this video reflection, we invite you to go with words eye to eye and Minister Ramon Jackson in this epiphany and revelation, thinking about, reflecting about what good religion is. So draw your minds to this and then prepare your hearts for community prayer, which will be led by our Bishop Yvette Flunder. God bless you and thank you so much for being with us today.
Hey, how you doing? You ever been shopping and doing some of the simplest stuff and end up with a word? That's what happened to me today. I was in the grocery store picking up a few things, trying to stay away from the people because, you know, people don't know what 6 feet is nowadays. And I get in line and I see this senior. She's one of the elders. She's standing in line, unfortunately, behind the wrong one. One of these youngsters that's rude and three much. You know what I'm talking about. All in the way, being extra loud, rude, talking to people disrespectful. It did something to me. And I ended up asking this woman if she wanted to get in front of me in the line. Now, y'all know how I am. I'm busy. I'm not going to let nobody get in front of me in the line. But I needed to today. So I let her in. Then the Holy Ghost got to talking. That's our senior, our elder. Another young lady is her. She don't know it yet, but let some time and some age get to her. She gonna wish somebody treated her with some respect and some dignity. Unfortunately, she ain't paying attention. But somehow or another, I was being respectful in a way that I wasn't even thinking about. That's my senior. I see her. I acknowledge her. That's our past and our wisdom. I mean, that woman has survived a whole lot. And just the simple fact of me letting her in front of me, she only had two items. That might have been all she was going to eat for the week. She needed a quarter. I gave it to her. It didn't take nothing off my back. But the Holy Ghost was talking. Isn't that good church? Good religion? Doesn't the word say that's how we're supposed to take care of our seniors and our widows and the orphans? So here I am standing in line, getting my stick of butter, container of milk, loaf of bread, and a big old blessing. Because I paid attention and honored somebody and acknowledged them for being present and worthy. It's an epiphany and a revelation. Bye, baby. I just had to drop that on you. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.
And now community prayer with Bishop Yvette Flunder.
God bless you, beloved. What a joy and a privilege it is to join with our family, close, in proximity, but also in diaspora all over the United States and world. We thank God for you. We're going to begin our time of prayer today with one very special reflection that I'd like to share. We've been blessed to have an incredible gift in the person of our own Shannon. I want to just say that Shannon has been to us and for us not only a presence, but a gift. She has been an artist with under a special and peculiar anointing. She has been a pastoral care provider with great detail. She has been an encourager in so many ways to her leadership. She is opinionated, which I like, I must say, very much. She is a dog parent, a puppy mama, who has asked those of us who have been dog parents, four-legged children parents, several pointed questions about what she might be able to do with such important realities as potty training. She has been a, her work in color and texture and design is in so many ways a divine gift and call. I'm amazed at people who can visualize what we really need to see in order to make the presence of the divine tangible and present with us. She has an anointing to dress the altar. That's a good way, I think, for me to put it. And she sees it visually, and then her hands and her gifts and skills can make it visible to us. It is an incredible gift. Sharon has been with us for quite some time. You've seen her many times. She's been here at PSR, Pacific School of Religion, in school. And she is graduating beautifully. And consequently, is moving back to be with other family physically. But thank God for virtual church. So I refuse to say that she is leaving. She is just relocating her computer. So she'll have to be connected with us
virtually the way many of you are. But what we will not be able to enjoy is the presence where we can go and have a cup of coffee up close. We'll have to work it out, Shannon. We'll have to sip online. We'll have to sip at a distance. You have been blessed by her, City of Refuge, and all of our diaspora. We have been blessed by her in incredibly wonderful ways, so many, many different ways, as a family near and far. And so we're going to pray for her today. Bid her Godspeed. We're going to pray very specifically today that all will be well on the other end, that she will not have adjustment hassles and struggles, that God will bless her heart because separation has with it some emotional bereavement. Always, when you leave a group of people that you love, when you leave a group of people that you can't stand, you bless God for it. But when you leave a group of people that you love, it can be painful and difficult. And it is a form of bereavement. And we will be praying for her that God will help her to adjust, but that adjustment will not be problematic, that she won't be hurt financially, emotionally, physically, spiritually, in any way, that God will help and bless her. And we will add her to our prayer list today. And we are also now praying for our brother Christopher Vinson, who is currently in hospital, praying that God will strengthen him. We're praying for Deacon Gail and family as they gather to take care of things in the closing, essentially, of her mother's life and goods and things. I know about this. It takes a little while to really get it done. And the prayers of the saints really do help us through those times. We lift in prayer our daughter, Erica Halliard. The doctors caught a heart disease, and she will be receiving a pacemaker in a few months. Thank God for catching this and being able to apply treatment. Thank God today for successful surgery for Daryl Nunley, who we've been praying for, and continued healing after that surgery. Prayers to Soma and family for healing from an infection and a family loss. The Curiel family for healing. They're requesting healing for mom's surgery. Praying for the Hayes family, the aftermath of a fire. Keeping our own son and brother, Sean Nunley, before God as he manages the stress of his job and career in politics. He's beginning to move on out there and get the work done. And he is asking properly that we would pray for him as he moves in that direction. Praying for Jen Steiner and family and the loss of her uncle. Praying for Anthony Arwine and the family in the loss of his father. And praying for our sister, Shell Lee. Praying for continued healing. Also for our own Deacon Vanita Taylor. And all of the prayer requests that have not been expressed, but are in the hearts and the minds of the people of God. We want you to know that it gives the family joy to know when folks believe in the power of prayer in the City of Refuge family. When you send in your prayer requests and you join yours with your siblings, your sisters, brothers, and siblings, we together praying for each other is what the body of Christ should do. When we connect our requests, our prayer requests with one another, and pray for one another, we can hear the scripture that says, pray one for another. There's something powerful about that. There's something significant when we go to God together as a community. It does not mean that everything that we ask God to do is going to come to pass the way we asked it. But what it does mean is that we cast our cares upon God, which by itself lifts us from the place where we are. And it means that we connect synergistically with one another. You care for me, I care for you, and that alone lifts a lot of the burden from what it is that we are carrying. I am blessed to know that you pray for me, and I believe that you do. And I trust that it blesses you to know that I pray for you. We together praying the will of God to sustain one another. That is really what it is about. So I'm going to ask you to turn your hearts and minds toward God, that you'll disconnect from whatever other busy work you may be involved in this moment, and focus on the prayer list and the prayers that were not listed in the prayer list. There are other things in your life and in the lives of those that you know. And let's turn toward God together today, trusting God to answer, to hear, and to answer our prayers. Let's go to God now. Gracious God,
yes, God,
by all of your many names and all of your beautiful and magnificent manifestations, we begin this time of prayer today lifting up our own precious and special and loved and cherished, yes, Shannon. Yes, she is so important to us, God.
Yes, God.
And she has proven to be such a literal part of this church family.
Yes.
That she will be missed being away from us physically.
Yes.
But we are grateful that there is no animus between us.
Thank you, Lord.
We are grateful that we are kin. Hallelujah. We are grateful that we know her deeply and she knows us.
Amen.
That we are not simply loving an image of who she is, but we truly know her.
Thank you, Lord.
Because she has been transparent and authentic among us.
Thank you, God.
And so we ask you for angel protection and traveling mercy.
Yes, God.
We ask you for the covering of your love.
Yes, God.
For your presence to give her direction. She has made preparation, but you must give her direction. She has done what it was that you required of her to prepare herself to do the work of ministry.
Yes, Lord.
She has experienced myriad emotional, relational, fiscal events in her time and life, but they did not deter her from her purpose.
Hallelujah.
She finished the course. Hallelujah.
Yes.
She did the work.
Hallelujah.
She passed on through whatever fire was necessary to complete her purpose, her education,
yes, God,
her preparation. And now, great God,
hallelujah,
we pray that first that she will allow herself to celebrate that victory,
yes, God,
and to thank you for a way made and a door opened. Hallelujah.
Yes, God.
And for the strength to finish. Thank you for that, God.
Hallelujah.
And help her to bless you for that through many dangers. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Toils and snares. She's already come. 'Twas grace that brought her safe this far.
Yes, God.
And that same grace will lead her on. Glory. Bless her now. Bless her. Bless her body. Bless her mind.
Glory.
I pray that you'll arrest anything that comes to, in any way, create sickness or times of lack of health. God, I pray in Jesus' name.
Yes, God.
That you will restore to her anything that the enemy has sought to destroy. Comfort her heart, comfort her mind. Help her to understand that she does not have to know everything about where you're taking her. Just cause her to understand that where you lead her, she must follow.
Yes, God.
Give her the strength now.
Strengthen,
the journey exciting. Hallelujah. Make the journey exciting and filled with all sorts of treasures and adventures and opportunities.
Yes.
Help her to understand that you have healed her for such a time as
Hallelujah.
Bless her now. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Bless her. Just bless her. Put your whole hand on her and bless her.
Yes, Lord.
And rebuke the enemy that not only comes against her from the outside, but rebuke the enemy that comes against her from the inside.
Yes, Lord.
And anything that speaks to her about defeat and diminishing herself in any way, come against it, great God.
Yes,
and
God.
Reveal to her
your
purpose for her that you planned before she was formed in her mother's womb.
Yes, God.
Hallelujah. Bless her now, I pray. In the strong name of Jesus. Plain path for her feet now.
Yes, God.
Help her to know she's not wandering in any wilderness. You have plain path intentions for her feet.
Yes, Lord God.
Cause her to know that she need only listen, that she need only put her ear to your heart.
Yes, oh God.
Where you lead her, hallelujah, if she will follow.
Hallelujah.
She will know what all of this has been for and what all of this has been
for. Glory to God, glory to God.
I trust you to do it, hallelujah. I've seen you do it.
Your great name.
I've lived it long enough, God, to know that you work just like that.
Yes.
Let it happen, we pray. In Jesus' name. And all of these who have put their requests in because they trust you. Hey,
yes, God.
Because they believe in you.
Yes, Lord.
Because they lean on you.
Yes, God.
Every one of us have come to you today with these requests, some spoken and some unspoken. Fix it, God.
Fix it.
Yes. And while you're fixing it, fix us.
Hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah. Fix it, God. And while you're fixing it, fix us,
fix
us, and fit us,
yes, Lord,
for the journey that you have called us to.
Yes, God.
I can feel the words of the song, and it wasn't a gospel song. It said, "I'm coming out."
Hallelujah.
We're coming out, God.
Yes, Lord.
We're coming out. We're coming out. We're not always to be in this place.
Yes, yes.
And in this situation, and we're not always to be in this quarantine and in this pandemic. We're passing through it. Hallelujah. There's an end of this, and there's a conclusion to this.
Hallelujah.
And there are lessons learned in this, but there's a coming out of this that you intend.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Help us to get everything you called us to get.
Yes, Lord.
From being in this place.
Yes.
So that when we come out of this place,
yes, Lord.
Yes.
We will be our best and highest selves. Yes. Let it be so. And we ask you specifically.
Glory to God.
To heal our bodies. Yes. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Heal our minds.
Yes, Lord.
Heal our interaction with one another.
Yes,
God. Yes.
Heal our addictions.
Hallelujah.
Yes, God. In the
heal
name.
Our sicknesses. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Heal our indifferences.
Glory
to yes, God.
Heal our priorities. Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus.
Heal our communities.
Yes, Lord.
Heal our nation.
Yes, God.
Heal our world.
Yes, God.
You're God, and there is nothing impossible with you. And the same God that can bring a bloom from a seed.
Hallelujah.
Is the God that can heal this earth and this planet and these systems and these governments and heal the church and heal families and heal epidemics and pandemics. You can heal, God. You can heal us from violence and hatred and racism and sexism and homophobia. You can heal us.
Hallelujah.
You are able. Your power is greater than the power of the enemy.
Yes, yes.
And just like we have seen a wave of despair, now we call into existence a wave of healing and hope.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Oh, I believe you, God.
In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah. Our lives were not designed to live down in a hole. We were not designed
to
live in day-to-day despair and struggle and sadness. My faith looks up to this. Hallelujah. Savior divine, now hear us while we pray.
Yes.
Touch, heal, and deliver. It is pointless for us to pray and not believe.
My God.
Yes.
It is pointless for us to pray and not believe. And so we speak into existence.
Yes, we do, God.
Those things that are not, hallelujah, as though they are.
Oh, yes.
I declare that I am healed.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I declare that
hallelujah.
I am made.
Hallelujah.
Hey, hallelujah. I declare that my finances are taken care of. I declare that my family is safe. Hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah.
I declare that my neighborhood is made whole.
Yes, God.
Glory to God. I declare today that families are safe. I declare that gun violence will come under control. I declare. I declare that sickness that is related to addictions and expressions of addiction and outcomes of addiction, that those things will be made whole in the name of Jesus, that secrets will be revealed.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Pray, Bishop.
And we shall live and not die.
Glory to God.
We believe it now. We believe
to God.
And we trust you for it.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. This is not a weak prayer. This is a prayer based on experience, knowing down through the years. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Yes, you've been good.
Hallelujah. Down through the years. You've been good.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You've been good.
Hallelujah.
You've been good.
Hallelujah.
You've been good.
Hallelujah.
We find no fault in you down through the years.
Hallelujah.
You've been good.
Bless you, Jesus.
Now help.
Bless your holy name.
Hallelujah. Wherever help is needed. Help. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus.
Glory to God.
In the name of Jesus.
Glory to you.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes, God.
We appropriate all the power that is in the, in the name of Jesus.
Over.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of all that is good. Hey, hallelujah. All that is mine, I appropriate it in my life. In the name of Jesus.
In your name.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. We're on our way up and out of here. In the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
We're on our way to finding out what it was all for.
Hey, hallelujah.
And we call it.
Hallelujah.
And we appropriate it now. Hey, hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah.
Hey. Yes, Lord.
We thank God. Amen.
Thank you, God.
Glory to the name of the Lord. Come on, everybody, everywhere.
Hallelujah.
Everywhere.
Thank you, God.
Everyone, everywhere.
Thank you, God.
Hear our voice. Give God your best praise. Come on, everywhere. Hey, hallelujah.
Bless your wonderful name.
Come on, give God your best praise. Give God, come on.
Hallelujah.
Give God your best praise.
Hallelujah.
Of your lips.
Hallelujah.
Give glory to the God that cleared your life. Come on.
Bless your holy
name. Give glory to the God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
From losing your mind. Come on. Give glory
to
God that made a way out of nowhere. That you still have a roof over your head.
Hallelujah.
That you can still stand up on your own legs. Hallelujah.
Bless your
name. Glory to God. You still have food in your cabinet, in your refrigerator. You still have an income, whether you have
a job or not.
Give glory to God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, God.
Great is the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Greatly
bless your wonderful name.
Hallelujah.
Yes, you are, God.
Hey, hallelujah.
You are, God. Greatly to be
praised. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, God, for this great woman.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Blessed Savior.
Great and mighty in all your works.
Yes, God. Thank you, God.
Thank you.
I say, family, prayer changes things, and so does what you do when you participate in the ministry of giving.
Amen.
I'm Deacon Gamage Carter, and at the City of Refuge United Church of Christ,
Glory
we seek to empower, enrich, renew, and renew disenfranchised and marginalized community, both locally and abroad. It is through generous donations from you, our family, friends, visitors, and viewers, local refuge programs such as the Word of Mouth Food Pantry and LGBTQ education inclusion work, as well as our missions in Mexico, national social justice equality through TFAM and international ministries in Africa, Asia, and the United Kingdom, can continue to make room at the table for everyone. We invite you to be a part of our efforts in providing practical, no-harm solutions to critical world issues. No donation is too small to make a difference. And giving is simple. You can give through text to give by texting 510-257-9001. Enter the amount that you'd like to give, press send and follow the prompts. Or PayPal at www.paypal.me/CORUCC or Cash App $CORUCC. We thank you for your gifts and for partnering with us in making someone's life brighter when things aren't so bright. And as we go ahead and give with a grateful heart, we'll be listening to You Can't Beat God-Giving by Billy Preston. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't try.
Mr. Ramon Jackson, here with today's scripture. Reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 4 through 9, New Revised Standard Version. For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. It is my honor to bring back our bishop, the Reverend Dr. Yvette Flunder, with today's empowering message, the uniqueness of your gift.
God bless you, beloved. It is my joy to share. I'm having a bit of a Holy Ghost moment. And the presence of God is very tangible in our worship today. I pray that you are experiencing the presence of God where you are and where you are worshiping, in your home, in your car. That I pray that the presence of God is breaking through in your spirit. We are in an incredible time. And I want to thank you, Minister Ramon, for reading this passage. I would like to add a reflection passage to the passage in 1 Corinthians 3. The passage that I'd like to add is in 1 Corinthians 12, an extension and then share a little bit of what is on my heart and mind today. It says that if the foot says, this is 1 Corinthians 12:15. If the foot says, I am not part of the body because I am not the hand, does it mean that I am not part of the body? And if the ear says, I am not part of the body because I am not the eye, does it mean that it is not part of the body? For if the whole body were an eye, what would happen to the hearing? And if the whole body were an ear, what would happen to the sense of smell? But as it is, God has placed each one of the parts in the body, just like God wanted. If all were one and the same body part, what would happen to the body? But as it is, there are many parts, one body. We've been talking for quite some time about the problematic reality of what we call the church. The question has been since the beginning of the year, in fact, since the end of last year, have we got good religion? And we have been using James 1:27 as our theme scripture for City of Refuge and for the entire fellowship. Good religion, have we got good religion? If good religion and undefiled is caring for the misfortunate, the unfortunate, for the most despised, caring for, in James' time, the widows and orphans, and living unspotted, undamaged, undefeated, essentially, by the systems of the world. If that is what is the realities of good religion, we've talked a lot about the identity of poor religion. But I think we need to start building ourselves up about what it means to have good religion. What does it mean? And I want to go to Corinth again, because there were two realities happening in Corinth that I want to lift up and share again. One was in the third chapter that Minister Ramon read, and the other was essentially in the 12th chapter, the systemic disease of the church at Corinth. And let me be even more specific. There were a group of people in the Corinthian church who said that basically I belong or we belong to Paul. There was another group in the church who said we belong to Apollos. Now, you didn't hear a lot about Apollos. We don't have an epistle written by Apollos. But apparently Apollos was a significant leader in the Corinthian church. And there were a group of people who considered themselves the disciples of Apollos, where others considered themselves the disciples of Paul. Now, we hear from Paul because Paul was a writer. He was the person who penned these epistles. I have often wondered what would Apollos have written if we had heard from him. We don't know, but we do know he had such a following that a number of people compared the work of Apollos to the work of Paul. Now, what Paul basically was saying to them is that each of them had a role. And the way he basically broke it down was that I planted, he's talking about himself, or I was the founder of the church. Apollos watered, which I'm going to assume because the record is rather poor on this. Apollos must have been who he left with the people because he was from church to church, as you know, in Asia Minor. I planted, Apollos watered. So let's say he is the pastor that was placed or the deacon that was placed. We're not certain. While Paul went on to do what he did. But God made it grow. And because of this, neither the one who plants or the one who waters is to be made special. Only God should be special because it is God who made it grow. That's the heart of what it was he was saying. The one who plants, the one who waters should work together. And each one will receive their own reward according to their labor. We're co-workers with God. If we are going to create what should be the church as it is envisioned by the will and word and intent of the heart of God, one of the principal things we will have to be prepared to push back against is the who is greater and the who is lesser. It is a cardinal sin of the church. And it is incredibly important to do the work that is necessary to name it and to put it precisely where it should be. And the Apostle Paul talks about this in this passage. I want to lift it up because we have numerous new members. And thank God for all of you. It's close to 50 people. God bless every one of you who have become a part of us in these months. And I don't expect that the growth of City of Refuge is going to slow down at all. I think that it is God's intention that we grow through and beyond the epidemic. But I also am very intent on us growing well. And there's a few things foundationally that I want to say to you who are new members and who are long-term members. Go back, some of you, as far as this upcoming 30th anniversary of City of Refuge. Let me be clear. Having a different role does not make any of us greater than the other. If you have a family and you have parents, you have children, you have grandparents, each of those aunts and uncles, how about that? How about some of those other things like other mama and big mama and cousin Bubba, you know, some of the people who are not really blood kin to you, but they are connected to you and you call them family. Anybody have folks like that? People that are connected to you that you call family. Each one of us have a role and a responsibility like cogs in a wheel. And when each of those cogs in the wheel are doing what is their task, then the whole vehicle moves forward. We are able to do what we need to do. But if the tire essentially refuses to turn and the steering wheel refuses to steer, the vehicle is in trouble. And what Paul suggests is one of the main problems out of the gate. And I need you all to hear me. This is the beginning of the church. They hadn't even gotten off the ground. And they were already deciding within this one congregation who should be the greatest, as though someone has to be the greatest. We are all given gifts according to what is the will of God for us to do and be, for the cause of God and the work of God in the earth. Those are the gifts that are given us. And can I also say to you, some of them, you're born with them. Others are enhanced by what you learn and experience. But every gift is equally as important as every gift. I need that to sit with you for a minute. Because the way that we understand church is often given to somehow suggesting that certain gifts are more important to God and other gifts are lesser important. And that's why when I was coming along as a young woman, everybody wanted to preach. Everybody wanted to be a deacon. I have been to some conferences in the church that raised me where I would say 75% of the men that were there were sitting in the preacher section because everybody wanted to preach, because somehow somebody made everybody believe that that was a power position. And can I just be perfectly honest with you? I would venture to say probably 2/3 of them had not been called to that ministry. But the truth is, that was what was available if you were going to have power. And the ones that wanted to preach among them, I'd say 50% wanted to start a church. And so on every block where there were storefronts, it was church after church after church after church after church. And I used to think to myself, wouldn't it be great if this, if 10 of them would get together and make one good church? But they couldn't get together because everyone wanted to have the power. Why? Because what we had represented to the church was that if you were going to be powerful, there were only a few jobs: preacher, pastor, deacon. How am I doing with that? Choir director, perhaps, head of the usher board. That's about, the list wasn't long. It wasn't long. And there were so many people who vied to have those positions that we had an overcompensation in certain categories because no honor was given to those categories that didn't fit in what was perceived power. Can I say something to you today? God doesn't see church that way. I have said many times before in reflections about President Barack Obama, and I want to say it again. The President Barack Obama, when we came to know him, we had very little information about his mother. We knew that his mother was white. We knew that his father was an African man. But what we didn't really realize is the energy and effort that she put into raising her two mixed race children. And the ways in which she saw to him having a stellar educational opportunity. The way in which she helped him and moved him from place to place to ensure that he had the very best that she could offer him. And when he grew and he expanded, it became clear that he was brilliant. It became clear that he had a bright future. She lived and died without most of us knowing her name. We know that she was a woman who was of European descent, but she came on and off the scene in the first or second year of his being our president. She passed away. But if it had not been for her, I need you to hear me, there would not have been a him. The ministry of those who helped us when we needed prayer, the ministry of those who helped me when I was a little girl trying to learn how to have relationship with God, the ministry of the big mamas and the other mamas and the big daddies and the cousins and the mentors and all of those who helped us through, we are the end result of their ministries. We survived because they helped us. I need you to stop for a minute and think of someone who grabbed your hand just before you went off the cliff. And understand that everything that you are could not be had it not been for someone who was there for you. You did not teach yourself to tie your shoes. You did not teach yourself how to do your own toileting. You did not teach yourself how to talk. You did not teach yourself how to do something with your hair. Somebody taught that to you. Even if you cannot remember specifically what the lessons were or who taught you, we are because someone else poured into us. So it is with the church. And sometimes the positions that are the least admired and the least fought for, the least desired, are the positions and the roles that are the most needed. Thank God for the people that clean up and don't complain. Thank God for the incredibly anointed cooks. Thank God for the people who secretly slip a little money in people's hands when they know that they're hungry. They don't need an announcement made about it. Thank God for the people who take care of the children, because everybody's not called to do it. Thank God for Apollos, who did not write an epistle. But when Paul was gone, what about Apollos? We don't hear much about him, do we? But Apollos was present. Can I just say it this way? Thank God. I thank God every day of my life for Pastor Ann Jefferson, who is the incredible glue who holds so many things together. And when people speak about City of Refuge and who we are and where we are and who we are in the world, they will know who I am, because part of my call is to be the founder, is to be a face, is to be in leadership, to have visionary roles. But they need to know something about Ann Jefferson, the person who sews it together. And if I try to put her on the front, she gets upset with me. You all know that, don't you? She'll tell me no. She likes to tell me no. She'll tell me no. No, I don't want it that way. But it would be so wrong and so ungodly for me to suggest that somehow or other I could do any of this work for 30 years without her help and her assistance. And the spirit in which she does it, which does not give conflict to her role and my role. How great, how gracious is that? Let me just say to you, beloved, we need more Apollos. And we need people to be needing to be, or called to be, or inclined to be the people that will see the power in the gifts that are oftentimes not as visible. Don't lust after, let me tell you what I know, the visible gifts. What you want to strive after are the things that God has called you to do. Because when all of the parts are working together properly, then the church can be more to the world than we can even imagine. We can be more to the systems, the political systems, the justice systems than we can imagine, if we are not striving for the pseudo realities of power. Power looks really great to have until you have it. And then you understand the incredible humility that has to be attached to it. Trust me. But I can also say to you that the place that you and I will work the best is in the place where God has placed us. I like what Paul said. It is neither the one who plants nor the one who waters. Mm-hmm. It is the one who makes it grow. It is neither the positions that you think powerful or the positions that you feel are diminished that really ultimately make it work. It is the one who makes it grow. It is the anointing and the hand of God that makes it grow. What God needs from us is to find our place and to work diligently in it, knowing that it is just as important as the ones that seem more visible. Hallelujah. Just as important, just as vital, just as necessary, whether you are changing light bulbs, whether you are helping to clean, whether you are caring for the children, whether you are doing planning, whether you are helping in community, whether you are feeding the hungry, whether you are caring for the needy, whether you are caring for the seniors, whether you are helping to teach the illiterate, whether you are helping with mental health services, whether you are just being a presence, someone that people can talk to, can share with. Not one of those gifts are lesser or greater than the other. There would not have been a church at Corinth had it not been both for Paul, who you know by his writings, and Apollos, who you only know simply because Paul talked about him. Can I just say to you that God sees,
yes,
and God hears and God knows. You've got to believe that today. Even what people don't see, what people don't hear. And I would go so far as to encourage you, when you do things unto God, one writer says, don't let the left hand know what the right hand is doing. I have learned something about that. I have learned that the best way for me to really bless God is to do things and never talk about it, never share about it, never say I did this or I did that. The greatest blessing comes is when somebody that you bless blesses you. Anybody understand me? Let others praise you and not your own lips. If you bless someone and you are blessing and they bless you, how wonderful is that? But bless them even if they never bless you, if the Spirit of God moves you to be a blessing. Bless wherever you can bless, because the God who sees in secret will reward you openly. Somebody who knows what I'm saying, say amen in your own home. And then I'm going to leave you with this. And that is from 1 Corinthians 12 and 15 through 20. It talks about the body, because Paul was trying to teach in Corinth what church is about. That's why I use Corinthians when God is reforming us, because to develop a church in Corinth was really something. Corinthians was like Las Vegas. Corinth was, I'm telling you. It was like, it was a lot going on in Corinth. It was known for its bordellos, for its prostitutes. It was known for the place to go, the destination city, for being scandalous. And somebody said, how can there ever be a church in Corinth? And isn't it something that most of the lessons about building church come from 1st and 2nd Corinthians? Even the mandate that we use for the Lord's Supper is in Corinthians. The book of Corinthians. I think of the book of Corinthians and I think of the genesis of City of Refuge many times. And what it is to plant a church right in a community that people try to suggest are communities of debauchery. I said, that's so like God. Hallelujah. Church in Corinthians. Church in Corinth. Church being born out of struggle, right in the midst of the hotbed of humanity. God plants a church. And then the church people who are born out of all of that then adopt and adapt the ways of churchology such that they begin to make some of them greater and some of them lesser. Get the lesson today. The Apostle Paul says, so now if the foot says I'm not part of the body because I'm not the hand, does that mean it's not part of the body? And the ear says, I'm not part of the body because I'm not the eye. Does that mean it's not part of the body? If the whole body was an eye, where would be the hearing? And if the whole body was an ear, where would be the smell? But God has placed each one of the parts of the body just like God wanted to. And if all were one and the same, we could not be the body. Hallelujah. What does it mean, Bishop? If all of us had not been through all of the different miscellaneous hell we've been through, and if all of us had not been through all of the different miscellaneous experiences that we've been through, we could not have come together and become a tool that God can use to be a blessing in the lives of people. Everything that we have been through was a part of our assignment. You're not better because you're the eyes. You're not better because you're the foot. You're not better because you're the liver. You're not better because you're the heart. You are needed. If you are a heart, we cannot get where we need to go if the heart is not beating. And if the feet are determined to be hands, we are in a situation because you cannot walk on your hands. If the liver wants to be the pancreas, we're in a snit because we cannot cleanse our blood with the pancreas. We need the liver to do that. We need the pancreas to create insulin. Yes. We need everything doing what it is called to do and not fighting against the will and call of God for the thing that you are called to do. Do not compete. It is a waste of time and energy. You were born out of time, or rather out of eternity into time with a purpose. Yeah. Find your purpose and your gift and work in your gift and do not waste your time and energy trying to be someone that you are not. Don't envy anyone because to whom much is given, much is required, Pastor Janice said to us. You don't want someone else's gifts because your grace gifts are for your call. You don't want someone else's call and responsibility. You want the things that will make you powerful and efficient in what you are called to do. And if you keep trying to be someone else, you will fail over and over and over and over. You'll get out there in the middle of the water and find out you cannot swim. If you are not called to be a swimmer, don't get out there in the middle of the water. Even if the swimmers make it look easy. There are grace gifts. We are born with them. Then life and experience and education hones our gifts, hallelujah, into something that God can use for God's glory. But you came here with a package. You came here with certain grace gifts. You came here with certain idiosyncrasies. You came here with certain passions. You came here liking certain colors. Come on, talk to me. You have a palate for certain foods. You have a sexual emotional orientation. You have a way that you think that was a part of the full package that you are, that God gave you to make you unique and special to what it is that you're called to. And it's just not going to work when you try to create something separate and different. Don't be jealous of anyone. Don't try to mimic. You're great. Hallelujah. All by yourself, great. And greater still, when yourself, when your gifts are connected to the body. And say, well, I just really don't know. Sure, you know. Maybe you don't like what you know. But you're pretty clear about what your grace gifts are. God knows how to design circumstances and ways for you to discover yourself and find out where you best fit in. So get in where you fit in and bring your gifts. If you find yourself having to continually cycle and fail and cycle and fail and cycle and fail, the probability is that you are in conflict with God about your gifts. Don't make small of the things that church makes small. Don't do that. Don't put on a robe and somehow think that a clerical robe makes you someone other than who you are. I cannot tell you how many people really ought to take their robes back and get their money. Because it never was the call of God on their lives. I want to say it to you the way that the Reverend Kendall Brown said it to us, who did all the preparation to get ready to pastor church. And one day he said to us clearly, this is not what I'm called to do. And he took a break after all of the school and all of the make ready. And when he emerged as a candle maker. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He emerged as a scent aficionado, but not just someone who loves scents, S-C-E-N-T, scent. He didn't just emerge as one. He emerged as someone who could blend them.
Yes.
That could create a shift in the mood, in the atmosphere. Somebody needs to hear what I'm saying today. And we were the people who tested the first few of them. And then it grew and it expanded and it exploded into an actual sensual ministry for him. And he's doing great and he has found his niche. Those of us that know him know that he has found his niche. Somebody said, well, that's not ministry. I said, well, why isn't it ministry? If it calms us, come on now. If it shifts our mood, if we can set, where's Shannon? Come on, Shannon. If we can set one of those candles down and meditate and pray and shift our atmosphere. Right now in the COVID, I imagine he's sold more candles than law the law allow, because we need to shift our atmosphere. How am I doing with that? I thank God for him. He's all over my house. He's all over my house. He wasn't all over my house when he was preaching, but he's all over my house when he became a minister of scents and shifting an atmosphere and preparing an atmosphere for meditation. Come on now.
Yes, yes.
And prayer. It's a gift. Now, they don't lift that up in the church. That's why we have to change the atmosphere. Somebody hear what I'm saying? In the church, the head would say to the foot, I have no need of thee, but try walking on your head. See how that works. The reality of it is, beloved, there is uniqueness in your gift. And I will close with this. While we are making ready to gather again, I took another look at the 12 steps of radical inclusivity, which is foundational to City of Refuge. And I want Pastor Ann to know that we'll probably be teaching from them one after the other in the next few times that we teach and preach. As we prepare to reemerge as a church from this pandemic, and I mean that physically, as we're making ready, as we are moving toward our 30th year anniversary, we're going to revisit the foundation and make sure that we have not left the landmark. And we are going to take a good and close look at encouraging us to stir up, hallelujah, the gift of God that is within us. Stir it up, beloved. Stir it up. Wake it up. Get it up and moving. Even if your name, like Apollos, is only mentioned once or twice in the text, his impact on the Corinthian church changed the church in Asia Minor. Changed. It was the parent church for all of the other churches. They spun off, essentially, from the power of the church in the wicked city. How about that? How important is it then that we stir up our gifts? And I want to say it again, when God makes it clear to you, this time, this cycle, get in agreement with God here. Don't push back against the will of God and the word of God. Listen to your pastor today. Stop arguing with God. Stop being frustrated with God. And I'll give you that simple wisdom that I learned again from my grandfather. He said, people always talking about, I'm trying to find the will of God. First of all, it is in God's best interest to let you know what God's will is for your life. It's in God's best interest. The second thing he said is that what you find yourself doing and doing well is likely the thing that you have been gifted to do. What you find yourself doing and doing well is likely the thing that God has given. So let's change the whole paradigm. Let's just shift the entire paradigm. What do you mean, Bishop? Let's act like there are no lists, no descending lists in terms of who is high and who is low in the work of ministry. And let's just believe and declare that all of us have tasks. All of us have calling. And let's spend our next few months, maybe our next year, maybe our next year and a half, discovering. Does anybody want to discover with me? Let's discover the gifts that are in us. Let's discover. How about that? Let's discover. Let's just go ahead on and say that we're going to discover things that have maybe never had a church name as a ministry or a gift, but we're going to discover those gifts among us. And we're going to lift those gifts up. And we're going to bless God for those gifts. They're in some of our elder people. We have never tapped them. They're in some of our children. We have never tapped them. They're in some of our people who are gifts on their jobs that they feel like they can't bring, come on now, to the church because we have not made room and space on the limited list of what is a real and authentic gift and an authentic call. Your gift is unique, but it came from God. You were born for this. This time, this place, and this hour. Now hear that today. You are unique. You are special. And you are called. And I want to take authority over everything in you and me that diminishes and defeats the intent of God, the will of God for our gifts and our skills to come to the front. God wants you to bring it, even if it doesn't feel real churchy. Bring it. We know what is problematic about Christianity. We know what is problematic, particularly about conservative Christianity in this current atmosphere that we are in. But we cannot just know what is wrong. The Spirit of God is calling us now to model what is God's will going forward. It's time for an exodus. It is time to come out and to declare what God has taught us during this time. God bless you all. I hope you've heard from Spirit in the way that I have in my private time. And I pray that we as a family will prepare. God bless you is my prayer. Amen.
Whew. My God, my God. What a word today. I would dare to declare to you, if you have not heard from the Spirit of God, then the ears of your heart are surely closed. Thank you, Bishop Flunder, for that reminding word as we are moving back, as we're moving and setting our sights on returning together. Thank you for reminding us that every single gift is necessary. There's not one gift that is not needed for us to live into our full purpose as the body of Christ, located under the name of City of Refuge. No hierarchies. It's why we have a shepherd's table and why we are so blessed and honored. And I personally, I'm blessed and honored to serve in this ministry that saved my life and my ministry. And I honor both Bishop Flunder and Mother Miller for the guides, the mentors, the teachers that they have been in my life and in all of our lives. And I also honor all of those who work alongside me and all of those who work with it. They have been teachers and mentors and guides, and that's what we're called to do in this time. So we do bless God for today's message. We bless God for our bishop. We bless God for Mother. And we bless God for all of you who are with us today. It really is our wish at the City of Refuge to offer our best in hospitality, community, and relationship. The greatest of these is relationship, not religion, not all the rules, but relationship and a relationship with your Creator, which is the ultimate embrace of love and safety that anyone can ask for. It doesn't matter your background, your education, your affections, your finances, your affiliations, your identification, your gender presentation, nothing, absolutely nothing, can separate you from the love of God, which is in Jesus, who is our Christ. So if you're inclined to accept the offer of relationship with Christ and claiming your gifts and your presence in Christ's body, then we ask that you acknowledge your RSVP at the table of life by typing hashtag Jesus in your comment section. Just hashtag Jesus, because there's nothing left to be said when you call on him. Just enter your message and one of our ministers will be in contact with you, and we welcome you home. And speaking of home, perhaps you don't have a church home or a supportive, inclusive community where you currently are residing. It could be that you've been praying for somewhere to worship, and right now and today you're here, and you may have questions, or you just need supportive shoulders to lean on. So we're inviting you today to become a part of the City of Refuge United Church of Christ community, both locally and abroad. Because we're operating in virtuality, you can join from wherever you are, and we have members as far away as the UK and Berlin and as close as Oakland. So you are welcome here. If that's your desire, type hashtag home in your comments sections, and our new members department will follow up with you with your official welcome. We offer you so many blessings from City of Refuge United Church of Christ and from the heart of God, who loves us all and has imparted unique and special gifts to each and every one, to the glory of God and the blessing of God's creation everywhere. Welcome home.
Good afternoon, City of Refuge. My name is Marilyn, and I serve as lay pastor with the worship and liturgy team. I'm here to do your announcements for the week. The City of Refuge stands with the Asian and Pacific Islander community. We condemn acts of hatred, bigotry, and violence. We remain radically committed to equality, inclusion, justice, and the eradication of racism on all its fronts. Join us today and every single day in stopping the hate in all of our communities, specifically in our Asian and Pacific Islander communities. Today, we have a wonderful special birthday. We want to say happy birthday to our Pastor Phil Gray. Yay! We love you, Pastor Phil. We are grateful that you are a part of us and all of the love and the ways in which you show up. We bless your life. Thank you so much and happy, happy birthday. Coming up, we know Mother's Day is soon to be upon us. We are inviting you, particularly our youth and children, to create a video that can be 1 minute to a minute and a half, to do a poem or some reading or just or a photo, but something that shares what mothering has meant to you and that reflects the mother in your life. You can send that video by next Sunday, May 2nd, to info@dbuilds.org. Again, that video is due next Sunday, and you can email it to info@dbuilds.org. And then coming up on May 16th, for our worship service, we welcome Dr. Tamara Lomax. She is the sister of our own Lorray Ganey, a profound scholar and activist and author, The Jezebel of Jezebel Unhinged. And if you haven't read it, please, please, please go out and get it at your local bookstore first. And then go to the one everyone goes to. I won't mention their names. Amen. But join us here Sunday, May 16th for worship service at 11 a.m. with Dr. Tamara Lomax. Those have been the announcements.
Today has been a wonderful, wonderful service. And we thank you for worshiping with us today. We pray and we know that you have been encouraged and transformed and truly blessed by our time together. If you are a first-time visitor, let us know in the platform of your system with hashtag visitor. Accepting a relationship with Jesus Christ today? Hashtag Jesus. Perhaps you'd like to become a part of the City of Refuge ministry. Hashtag home is all you need to write. Our welcoming team will contact you shortly via Facebook Messenger to move you forward. And if you're watching this service outside of our normal broadcasting time on Facebook Live and now YouTube Live, you can just send us a message to cor.refugee@gmail.com to join. Welcome home. If you'd like to partner with this ministry and aid in our efforts both locally and internationally, you can use Cash App at $CORUCC or PayPal at paypal.me/CORUCC. Or text again by texting 510-257-9001, entering the amount that you'd like to give and following the prompts through EasyTie. Bishop Yvette A. Flunder, Mother Shirley Miller, and the City of Refuge Ministries want to hear from you. So please send us your prayer requests, comments, or questions via Instagram at Refuge UCC, Twitter and Facebook at City of Refuge UCC. The heresies of the body of Christ are figments of our imaginations of power. There is no part of the body more important than another, and all the parts that make things work aren't visible. Our gift in God is the uniqueness of our individual creation and experiences. Are you the ear, the leg, the arm, the eye, the heart, or the spleen? The baker, the candle maker, the dancer, the drummer, the janitor, the one who encourages, or the one who tills the soil. Let the uniqueness of your function in the body of Christ be the blessing of the gospel it was intended to be the active inclusion of the full array of God's magnificent design. Equally divine, equally necessary, equally anointed to plant or to water, so that God may make it grow. We have had a wonderful service today, and we're leaving you with a classic, Oh Happy Day, by the Edwin Hawkins Singers. Have a wonderful afternoon. Grace and blessings.
Oh!